Hello, and welcome to this installment of our RSA Conference webcast series. I am your host, Kacy Zurkus, content strategist for the RSA Conference team. During the webcast, all participants will be in listen-only mode. Our panel of esteemed guests will be taking questions throughout the session, so if you do have a question for them, please submit it through the Q&A feature down below. As a reminder, this webcast is being recorded, and following the webcast, you will receive an email containing the link to the video replay. The replay will also be posted to rsaconference.com. I would now like to ask our panelists to introduce themselves so that we can get started.
Great. Well, thanks, Kacy. Thanks so much for having us. Hi, I'm Jeff Klaben. I'll be kind of leading the discussion with the group here today. So I'm primarily an applied cybersecurity and IT practitioner. I've worn the CISO and CIO hat several times. And I also teach, research, invent, and build programs to connect various disciplines like engineers, lawyers, and business folks, and to build communities across private sector, government, and academia. Irina?
Hi, everybody. I'm Irina Raicu. For the past 8 years or so, I've been the director of the Internet Ethics Program at the Markkula Center for Applied Ethics at Santa Clara University. I write and speak and present about a variety of issues like privacy and cybersecurity, data ethics more broadly, and various other topics that are going to be relevant to our discussion today.
Hi, everybody. I'm Scott Sorochak, CEO of SparkLabs Foundry. I've been out here in Silicon Valley for just over 30 years, which is both it's both exciting and terrifying at the same time. Engineer by trade, and in the last 30 years, when I look at my companies I've worked at, it's always been sort of at the intersection of where startups and large MNCs meet for innovation. And I've always been super fascinated with helping companies to innovate and accelerate their innovation program. So thanks for having me today.
And we've got Mike.
Hi, I'm Michael Henry. Yeah, thanks, Jeff. Michael Henry, I started my security and IT career in the early 90s. I was fortunate enough to help some technology-focused companies like SGI and Applied Materials build out their security programs. Some of the things we were doing back then lay the groundwork for trust models that their current CISO is actually running to this day. I spent some time overseas with Ericsson, working in some complex ecosystems, and then came back to the US as the CIO for Rovi and then Digital Realty, managing IT and security for their data center business. 2018, a few of us were talking around the water cooler about the state of security and how hard it was to find good partners that really wanted us to make us more successful at the business level. And the more we talked about it, the more we discovered we were all passionate about making it easier for security leaders to run effective programs. And so to bridge that gap, we started Arbala Security, and we've been on that mission ever since.
Wonderful. Thank you all so much for joining us. Jeff, before I turn it over to you to moderate the discussion, I just wanted to ask, what inspired this topic for you?
Cool. Well, thanks, Kacy. You know, I was at the RSA conference in February and led a couple of sessions. One was about imagining a more civilized internet. And now I realize that the world is increasingly calling upon us to use not only our natural but augmented brain power to not only perceive our current reality and understand our problems more keenly, but to also anticipate. We can try to think ahead more effectively. So yeah, I've been researching this idea of the art and discipline of anticipation. In simple terms, there seem to be two natural starting points for this cycle of thinking. You know, one is about understanding our environment and dealing with, you know, basic threats to our survival. The second is becoming more conscious of opportunities to advance and improve our lot in life. And I think intertwined between these two modes of thought is a struggle between right and wrong, good and evil, or, you know, however you might describe it. So I think we should cover more than just cybersecurity in the next hour, but I think that's a common area of interest and probably a good place to start. And so I thought our three speakers can really round out these three ideas, with Mike having been in the trenches and being a CIO, with Scott really helping organizations drive and build innovation programs and bringing the business perspective, and Irina, perhaps most importantly, helping us sort of balance our thinking with how do we systematically think about the ethics and the trade-offs between, defense and planning for the future. So let's start with the meat and potatoes, though. Mr. Henry, what do you think about managing and communicating risk? For our audience, what comes to mind first, and who comes to mind first?
I think it's two things, Jeff. The first is to remember our biases. Do we as individuals think about risk in terms of planning for maximum damage or most probable outcome? Traditionally, people have been fairly optimistic. There's a huge optimism bias we have. But, given that the rate of change is increasing and we're dealing with ever more complex systems, there's all these unrecognized dependencies, and I think you can make a good case that our risk models ought to operate on the basis of assuming maximum damage, not the more optimistic view of probable outcome. And I think the news reports of cyber attacks and breaches kind of show us that our view of risk hasn't necessarily kept up with these changes. Second thing I think about would be the way we align our business partners and how do we talk about risk? Do we talk about risk at a unit level or at a functional level, or do we talk about it at a business or a systemic level? And aligning those partners and how we manage that risk is critical, extremely critical, right? So when I think about who, I think about everybody that I interact with as a CISO. I think about my team, my peers, the executive team inside of the company, and then the board. All of those people, I really need to understand how do I bring that picture of risk together.
Thank you, Mike. I think we'll have to come back to the CISO perspective. I've certainly been there, and I know you have, and I think we'll go a little deeper there. But just to juxtapose with what Scott has to offer here, and I have a confession to make. When I was researching this topic, I thought about bringing in a quote from Jack Ma, the CEO of Alibaba. And so, he was quoted as having said recently, for people in business, 2020 is really just a year of staying alive. Don't even talk about your dreams or plans. Just make sure you stay alive. And you know what? I almost referenced Jack as having actually said that, and something made me a little uneasy. I anticipated I was missing something. And so I realized that's fake news. That actually is not attributable to him. But it still spurs an interesting question. So I almost fell for it. Scott, thinking about whoever had the interest in advancing that idea, what's most troublesome about that thinking from your perspective? Should we be thinking now in this pandemic and hopefully soon post-pandemic reality, about just getting back to normal, or is innovation now still important? Is there, is this the right time to think about evolving out of current challenges?
Yeah, that's a great question, Jeff. I think I'll answer it in two ways. The first is, like everybody, I think dealing with this pandemic, which none of us has had to deal with, certainly at least from what I can tell on the phone or on the video, we all sort of get back to our ground, what is our ground zero, right? Which is our family, the safety of our family and our friends. We all like to think that we have work-life balance, but at the end of the day, during a pandemic, it's all about, ensuring safety. But when we think about innovation, at least when I think about it, which is right soon thereafter, safety of family and making sure everybody is safe. Innovation, in my view, does not change. Innovation in terms of how people think about moving their company forward, moving their teams forward, and whether that's technology, whether that's services. There are countless examples in not just Silicon Valley, but globally, about when innovation stifles and what impact that has, not just on the organization, but on entire industries. We can talk about that a little bit later, but to me, what the pandemic has created is a slowing down of investment, perhaps in innovation, perhaps a reduction in workforce that affects innovation. But what I'm hearing, certainly through all my conversations with global innovation leaders, is that innovation is not slowing down per se. It is that you have to be expected to do more with less. Innovate fast, innovate faster, but with less resources, less money right now, because companies are focusing on sustainability. They're focusing on moving their companies quarter by quarter. But, you know, at the risk of being self-serving, in my world, companies are not dramatically saying, do not innovate. We cannot afford to innovate for the next 12 months. I think that if anything, they're being expected and their teams are being expected to innovate, but with a little bit less.
It seems like asking folks in Silicon Valley to go back to normal is fundamentally abnormal because it's a sort of continuous cycle of disruption. Normal is what's already happened. Would you agree that it's a pipeline?
Yeah. I mean, that phrase is a little bit overused. You know, what is the new normal? Are we getting back to the new normal? That's going to be for historians to debate, you know, 10, 15, 20, 30, 50 years from now. I think the best advice I'm giving mid-market and enterprise customers related to innovation is you are going to have to do more with less, at least for the time being. And there is no new normal other than if you are in and around innovation and you touch innovation in your job, you cannot slow down. Not just Silicon Valley, but the world is littered with companies that have felt as though they've had a commanding lead in the market, and they have allowed themselves to be lulled into this sense of security where they and their market leadership position, you know, is going to enable them to last the next 5 to 10 years. And I can tell you, having been in business for 30 years, not just Silicon Valley, but the world, I have seen it, you know, companies just completely decimated by not allowing themselves to constantly challenge their teams and challenge their organizations at either disrupting or making changes to their organization that are for the better.
Thank you, Scott. So this new normal idea, however we frame it, however we think about it, things are different now. I know, you know, I tend to be an extrovert, and being cooped up is just a little harder. Like, I feel like I'm missing something. That spark isn't always there. Sometimes it is. So I think about, you know, what inspires me and what motivates me. What you do certainly does, right? You're trying to help organizations find the path to the future. What Mike certainly, you know, is doing around helping folks have not only structured approach to, you know, cybersecurity and risk management programs, but, you know, do it with true efficacy. Maybe the thing that's most inspiring to me is what Irina is doing and what the Markkula Center for Applied Ethics is doing. And this, you know, this idea that there's hope that folks can be civilized, that the polarization of the public maybe is just on the surface, that there's a more effective way to kind of work through these, you know, terrible challenges and suffering that folks are facing right now. But that said, Irina, you know, we've talked about how we think about these things. And you talked about remembering to think about the terrible people. Is that counterproductive? What's important about that? Or can you give some context?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think you almost make us sound more optimistic maybe as a center than we are. In terms of the ability to really kind of reform society and move the conversation in a different direction. We're certainly hopeful but that's a pretty heavy lift. What I will say about thinking of the terrible people is, first of all, that I don't have to say that to cybersecurity folks. They're thinking about the terrible people all the time. But that is actually the name of a tool from something, a set of materials that the Markkula Center for Applied Ethics has put out on our website called an ethical toolkit. And the idea of these tools is to operationalize ethical analysis and ethical thinking into the technology design, development, and deployment process. So there are 7 tools that are all meant to be very practical and integrated into what organizations already do. And a lot of people have been thinking about these things for a long time. It's not that we created the ideas. But one of the tools is called Think About the Terrible People, and it basically says, when you design something, and technologists tend to be very optimistic and think of all the positives, you know, this goes back to your point about anticipation and anticipation of risk in particular. You really need to think about how your, you know, new features and tools can be misused. I was looking at the ethical toolkit again in preparation for our conversation, and I realized that the tool titled Think About the Terrible People actually starts by quoting something that CEO Eric Schmidt said at RSA in 2017, which was really not that long ago. He said, "We now find ourselves back fixing the internet over and over again. You keep saying, why didn't we think about this? Well, the answer is it didn't occur to us that there were criminals." That is an actual direct quote, not fake news. And I'm trying to imagine the sound of hundreds of jaws dropping at that statement. But that's the kind of thing that we're seeing. And when you presented the framing of this conversation, I found myself looking at the toolkit and realizing that so many of the tools were really about risk anticipation and mitigation. And the idea is that having done that repeatedly through the process, you will actually have better products and, you know, better effects on society. And the whole goal of everything we're all doing is to have a better world in which we all live more happily and pleasantly. So these are the very first tool is actually called ethical risk sweeping. And it talks about the need to anticipate not just the kind of risk that we've kind of grown, you know, accustomed to looking for, like privacy risks, like cybersecurity risks when you connect anything to the internet, but other risks that will have, an ethical impact and will create ethical controversy. And just to give you an example, when Duplex came out, when Google came out with this product that was supposed to make chatbots sound much more human-like, have the kind of vocalizing, remember that? That was not a privacy issue. That was not a cybersecurity issue. And, you know, the engineers presented it very proudly as something that will make the technology more kind of human. And the answer was a resounding, no, you're trying to mislead us, right? That was an ethical controversy that could have been anticipated, I think, by using some of these tools.
So living through a black swan event as we're doing now, right, this once in 100 years pandemic scenario, does that heighten our senses? And are we going to, you know, instinctively be more anticipatory about risk? Is there a risk that that's going to take us too far, or that we'll be obsessed with the same types of problems and miss the next type of black swan?
Yeah, my concern is that from everything I'm reading, our senses are not getting heightened, they're getting dulled, and that fear and lack of certainty are not good drivers for clear, cautious thinking, which is the kind of thing that we need. And that in response to fear and lack of certainty, we sometimes throw out various measures, including technological measures that we hope we work, that haven't been tested enough, that, you know, haven't been developed with enough consultation from the impacted groups, because we're so eager to try to get a handle and to make things better. So I think there are grave risks in the current environment.
So it seems like we're hopefully living up to our title here. We talked about the idea of, you know, thinking, managing, and then communicating. So your tool, the Markkula Center's ethical toolkit sounds like a way to structure our thinking so that we can move to action maybe more constructively.
I hope so, and I would really encourage anybody to take a look. These are free materials on our website. If you just, you know, search Markkula Center Ethical Toolkit, you will see them. And each of the tools comes with an implementation example. And the whole point is to make them really practical and useful. One of the tools, by the way, is about case analysis. And it's a way of sort of grounding this broader discussion of anticipating risk in real stories that have already happened. And what can we learn from cases that are either, you know, where things went wrong or that we can use as exemplars for how to do something right.
And I think just for our audience, these tools can be found on the scu.edu website. And I believe Markkula is spelled M-A-R-K-K-U-L-A. That should be enough to find him, right?
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Irina. So let's jump back to Michael Henry for a moment here. Let's talk about being systematic or programmatic. In risk management, it seems like that's all about frameworks and standards. But these frameworks and standards can be totally overwhelming to, well, not only somebody who's new to the business, but even existing practitioners. It's big and lofty and complex. I mean, what do you make of that? How do we turn that into something manageable? Mike?
We might have some connection issues. Yeah, he's out in the country, so
cattle ranch down in Texas. So we have to let the bits propagate back up here. We'll see if we can get him rolling.
While we're doing that, Jeff, let me jump in with a question from the audience, and then when Mike is back on, we can return to that question. But Raj wants to know: does the pandemic reflect the business continuity operations plans were not comprehensive in nature, and how is this pandemic different from a natural disaster like a tornado?
Oh, wow. What a wonderful question. I think about, you know, continuity planning, contingency planning as sort of a spectrum, right? So we go from an incident, which is, you know, limited frame of time, to a disaster, to, you know, a question of business continuity. Can the organization remain as a going concern over a longer period of time? And I think the pandemic is actually pushing up to the outer limits of some of these questions. It's, for some, it's business as usual, but for some, it's fundamentally a threat to the organization's very survival. Well, whether that's good or bad probably doesn't need as much judgment, but could business continuity planning be more effective in dealing with pandemic? Well, you know, case in point, it's interesting how firms like Costco or Target emphasized having fresh groceries in, you know, their retail environments for various reasons. But it turns out that that's also giving them a potential revenue pop, and now a tremendous valuation pop from investors, that they're selling some nuts and bolts, some fundamentals that consumers need, and it's keeping a cycle of business. Whereas retail firms like Kohl's are more in jeopardy. So where does business continuity stop and overall business strategy start? I think that's the final frontier. But I think that's where we start to brush up against innovation and business strategy, and there I'll defer to Scott's opinion.
Well, to jump in just for a second on the second part of the question, which was about how this is different from a natural disaster, One answer I've heard is that the natural disasters tend to be localized. So if there's a lot of disruption in one area, there are ways of, you know, functioning around them. With the pandemic really sweeping worldwide, it's forcing us to realize just how interwoven we all are now. It's maybe an opportunity to rethink some of the systems that had depended on, you know, the biggest disruption being only to a particular zone.
Scott, did you have anything you wanted to add?
Yeah, I think for the most part, for me, related to innovation, what we're finding is that even during this pandemic, people are still accelerating innovation plans. They're utilizing both internal and external companies to help them move technology or services forward. But they're doing that in a way that allows them to create even modest, scalable, repeatable processes, so that as companies are starting to hire more, invest more in innovation, they've developed that programmatic, systematic framework for now creating repeatable processes. And there's a lot of manual processes that still exist within both mid-market and large MNCs. And I think that this time, if you look at the glass half full, is giving innovation departments the ability to test a number of different companies external to their organizations that can help them innovate as people come back to work more cohesively as a team. And as those innovation strategies are actually proving out to be successful, the documentation, the programmatic, systematic way of scaling that is now going to then kick it from third gear to sixth gear. And that's at least what we're seeing, you know, during this pandemic.
It seems like, and I haven't thought about this until the question just sort of brought it up, but from an incident to a disaster recovery to a business continuity plan, those all emphasize holding on to what's normal, what's stable, and which is valuable, right? And that's what we count on. And if anyone's ever worn an operational hat, you know, you try to keep things stable and normal as much as possible. But it seems like the, like a ship navigating, you might encounter something that requires you to renavigate. So it's perhaps the frontier beyond business continuity is an innovation program, the ability to pivot or rethink or plan for the future, that sometimes continuity implies staying on a certain course, and that course might not be realistic anymore. Would you agree, Scott?
Sorry, absolutely. Having a problem with the camera. No, absolutely. And what's again interesting is that we're not seeing this just at the large MNC level, but we're seeing this at mid-market and even smaller companies. So no, Jeff, I completely concur with that.
Cool. Thank you. I thought it might be interesting to bring a classroom exercise into the program here. And I teach a course for graduate students on how to communicate across disciplines. So we can maybe do this two ways, but Scott, starting with you, especially because we can hear you, which is wonderful. How would you go about encouraging leaders of organizations to embrace planning for innovation in programmatic ways and systematic ways? Without pitching your business specifically, how do you pitch this idea or this way of thinking? And how is that something that tech leaders, cybersecurity leaders, can benefit from understanding?
Yeah, I mean, especially related to cybersecurity and security as a whole for companies of all sizes. I can't think of maybe more than five or six industries where innovation needs to be at the forefront of both investment and people's mindsets. The risk of not innovating, of not staying 1 to 2 to 3 to 16 steps ahead of, you know, viable, credible threats against your business, against your company, against your employees, against your country, if you want to take it to that level, there is nothing more paramount. Other than your personal health and security. So to me, when I meet with business leaders of all sizes, you know, I ask the basic question, what is the most important thing in your business? It's unfortunately, in many ways, you get a number of different answers, but it is your employees and your customers. Those are the two things that usually come up. And as it relates to innovation, as it relates to staying on the forefront of protecting those two valuable resources in any business, security and investment in security and staying on the forefront, 1, 2, 16 steps ahead of those threats against those two things is just, I mean, it's impossible to describe why that would not be the most important thing in your business. And yet at the same time, unfortunately, what I'm seeing is that companies, as it relates to the percentage of R&D that they're spending, security is not something that people are spending a proportionate amount of their revenues on. And that is something that when I highlight the risk and the exposure that companies have, aside from the obvious, I just try to do my best to illustrate what the cost and what the risk of not investing in innovation in those areas can be.
So, yeah, hey, Irina,
Scott, do you mind
about...
if I...
Oh, great. Thanks. Go ahead.
Sorry, Jeff. I was going to just jump onto what Scott said there. I think that's an interesting point, Scott, for two reasons. I think the first being a lot of times security in an organization, if it's viewed as a overhead cost or you know, just a cost of doing business, it's not seen as an enabler. It's seen as something that kind of fits after the first or second or maybe even sometimes the third round of resource allocation decisions are made. So we see that a lot where companies, you have security leaders who are stuck in the position of trying to do the things they think they need to do to manage risk, but because it's not connected to business outcomes, it sometimes gets pushed off to the next fiscal year, or you know, maybe we can only give you 10% of what you asked for. So I'm right there with you. Being able to connect that to driving business forward and making those customers successful is a key reason to make that security program effective and making sure that innovation is a key part of that.
Also, I mean, I find it fascinating that that's somehow seen as independent of the business progress. I fail to see how that's even still, you know, the reality, although I know that it is. You know, at the risk of being accused of pandering to the current audience, I've been saying for quite a long time now that cybersecurity has become one of the conditions required for the common good. When you talk about, you know, everything from pacemakers to the electricity grid being connected to the internet, and given all of the failures that we've seen, including, you know, all of the personal data of anybody working for the federal government being siphoned out of the OMB, how could cybersecurity be seen as anything less than what enables all of the rest of us to function? We really, speaking of communicating about risk, somehow we really all need to get better at that, apparently.
Thank you. So, Scott, you talked about thinking 16 steps ahead. How, and we've got Mike on here who's leading, you know, a private sector business, you know, providing, I guess, managed security services. And, you know, how would you pitch, you know, creating programmatic innovation to you know, an organizational leader like Mike? What's, you know, where do you start? Is there a set of tools like Irina's described in ethics? Does that translate? How do you put some structure around it?
No, I think it's a fair question. And Mike and I haven't spent a lot of time together, but we do spend quite a bit of time in the discovery process of our business, just really trying to understand where people's heads and thoughts are around innovation related to this. And the first thing that we go through is trying to understand where the measured risk is in their business, right? If you are a security agency, if you're an agency like the CIA, the NSA, their tolerance and risk of automating programmatically secure solutions is paramount. They're spending a lot of money around that. Companies that are perhaps just storing public documents that do not have a high level of security risk, their tolerance is much lower, their spend is much lower. And so really what it comes down to is, what is the risk tolerance for employees and for customers related to the business that is going to allow you to figure out proportionally to the revenue that you're generating what that number is related to the investment. And related to the investment, you then start to drill down deeper into channels of what is the investment related to the resources, what is the investment related to the tools and technology, and then what is the investment related to the ongoing expense and investment for ensuring security within your organization and your customer base. And I usually ask those questions, whether it's the NSA or the CIA, or whether it's, you know, a local, retail company that's looking to improve their security. I don't know if that completely answers your question, but that's the structure of how we think about it.
It's a hint. I really wanted something I could take back to the office and use this afternoon, but I guess it may be a little more complicated than that.
Can I jump in really briefly here, Jeff? I want to make sure that we broaden the group from just talking about customers and employees to talking about stakeholders, because a lot of the innovation that we're talking about impacts a lot more people than just the immediate companies, customers, and employees. And we're hopeful that you know, any innovator will start to think more broadly about all of the impact that stakeholders. And when we talk about risk profiles, you know, sometimes companies have a certain kind of customer in mind and sort of build for that customer, and don't think, for example, about domestic violence victims who might have a very different risk profile than other people who may be, you know, both groups may be customers, but they might really have very different sensitivities and needs. So how do we make sure that we think very broadly about the stakeholders and that we actually listen to them? So one of the tools in the toolkit is called expanding the ethical circle. And making sure that you bring in the perspectives of groups who are not part of your team and not part of your enterprise already, and that you don't fall prey to groupthink, especially with technologists who tend to be, as we said, very optimistic and, you know, very focused on building great things, but who might not be aware of some of the groups who, for very good reasons, might be reluctant to engage with some of this innovation.
And perhaps
that's a great point, Irina. I wanted to
go ahead, Kacy.
Jeff, I wanted to jump in with a question from the audience. Irina, I love listening to you talk about ethics, but the question from the audience is about risk models. Since we're on that topic, what do you think about having a centralized tool to manage and monitor risks all the way from risk models to the control level and vice versa? And also, what do you think about applying AI and ML proactively to manage and predict control levels and vice versa? To manage and predict risks.
Ooh, juicy question.
I can take a stab at that if you like.
Great, thank you.
Thanks, Kacy. So we like that idea, right? One of the things you see a lot is that we have this complex operation going on. There's all sorts of data points being captured in this complex operation. And yet when security leaders are asked by either auditors or compliance folks or by all kinds of different third parties, they often leave the data set they have and then move over to a spreadsheet and then fill out a spreadsheet. So having that connection between the operational data, the control set, and how those control sets apply to the risk profile you're trying to drive to, and being able to assess that and get help from either machine learning or different models to either do scenario planning or to drive you towards prioritizing decision making. I absolutely love that. In fact, those are the kinds of things we're trying to build as we talk about creating more effective programs.
The risk register has been this holy grail. And I think just making a list of problems, it has value in a certain way, but it's not enough to manage and to gain control over those systematically, right, in a way that prioritizes. I think a methodology that puts these tools in balance, besides having folks who are sort of well-versed in systems thinking, is agile methodology, right? You have this idea that you are dynamically checking in and looking at priorities and perhaps risks, and using this idea of a backlog or what's next most important, recognizing that you just won't tackle every risk, that sometimes you can quantify these things, sometimes you have to adapt them based on what's changing the world more dynamically, but it's dangerous to simply rely on ML, machine learning, deep learning, to point you in the direction of patterns in data and activity. It's taking that insight and putting it into a structured way of thinking rather than blindly relying on it. But together, I think it's wickedly powerful.
Yeah, I agree. And you bring up a good point that ties back to the innovation piece, right? Agile requires you to think in shorter batches, faster time to value, failing. Someone coined the phrase years ago to fail fast, right? But to keep learning and to keep innovating, and why innovation is so important now I'll go back to something I said earlier. The rate of change is increasing along with the complexity of the systems that we're dealing with. So an intuitive status quo oriented model just isn't going to serve leaders anymore.
And just to sort of round it out, I know, Mike, we lost you for a moment, but I was hoping to get your perspective on these frameworks that some folks find daunting. NIST, which I find to be the authoritative source on how to use language to describe technology. But you folks look at that and sometimes get a little overwhelmed. Are those frameworks useful? How can folks sort of dip their toe in that and crawl, walk, run rather than try to bite the whole elephant at one time?
Yeah, it is a challenge, right? Because even the National Institute of Standards and Technology has tried to publish implementation guides. And I think if we take that agile mindset that you brought up just a second ago, it's really looking at those five core areas inside of the NIST CSF framework and starting to understand what value each of them create relative to where you're at today. So there's ways to kind of break that down and eat it in smaller pieces. And oftentimes what we see happen is when companies try to take the whole thing and try to do it all at once, it becomes so daunting, it turns into shelfware when it really should be an ongoing tool that a security leader is using to build trust with his peers, with his management team, and with the board to show that programmatically the system is getting more effective. And that's not a one and done kind of thing. It's not an all or nothing kind of thing. It's a iterative, agile, constantly evolving approach. And actually, if you take that approach to it, the framework is a beautiful tool to help you do that.
I think it's so interesting. I just read a blog by some of the folks involved in Microsoft's efforts around AI ethics, and the blog writer literally said that engineers often ask for software when what they really need is frameworks. And the frameworks are just tools to help them think through certain decisions, but they still have to do the thinking and the processing, right? And it's sometimes hard to just tell people that you can't have software for this. You know, there is no ethics algorithm, for example, although some people are trying to build it. It just doesn't work that way. And reality is just so complicated that you need people with experience and understanding to participate actively and make those decisions. And then, by the way, also accept that nobody will ever be able to foresee every possible risk, and some there will be failures. And then the question becomes how do you respond to those failures in such a way that you will feel like you've done the best possible job?
Irina, I want to stick with you for a minute because we have a question from the audience that you had mentioned the, all of the stakeholders and considering the stakeholders. This person, Sheldon, would love to hear more about how to communicate security issues and risks to the C-suite, not to mention the enterprise risk management team.
I don't know that I have a detailed answer sort of targeted to particular groups. And I think the C-suite in particular is starting to see cybersecurity as an issue that they need to be paying attention to. I've seen, you know, various seminars being offered, you know, particularly to board members to, you know, to explain why this is so important. But I think that idea of stakeholders and who are all the groups who are impacted by the technologies and by the potential cybersecurity failures. I mean, when Scott was talking earlier about, you know, state-level issues and national security, you know, in those terms, we are all stakeholders, right? All of us, every citizen of the country. So I think, again, probably the best way to get the message across is through case studies to find, and you know, we see stories in the news about every day about some failure that really caused the problem, both for the companies themselves and then for people. I mean, one of the paradigmatic examples were the internet-connected pacemakers that suddenly had to be patched with great speed because vulnerabilities were found. Well, that was definitely not good for the companies that was making those devices, and it wasn't good for the people who had pacemakers in them and for all of their family members and everybody else who might be facing the possibility of having a pacemaker implanted. And it was fascinating for me to read, there were a couple of articles that I thought were very powerful by cybersecurity researchers who themselves found themselves in a situation where they had to have emergency procedures to have these things implanted. And they wrote about it afterward, about the fact that, you know, at that point where you're being told you need to have a pacemaker put in right away, you're not asking about the security features. But when you wake up afterwards, you do start asking, and apparently the answers were terrifying. So there were entire groups kind of coalescing. You know, it really sharpens the focus when you suddenly have an internet-connected device in you. And I think, you know, unfortunately, I mean, it would be great if we could do more of the anticipatory stuff, right? But right now we have plenty of stories through which to educate people about the current risks.
And sticking with that question of communication, we have another one from Caleb. How do you communicate risks in a non-technical manner to help the board steer the conversation and resulting actions toward programmatic improvements in funding, security operations, and capabilities? And I'll just throw that out there for anyone to answer, Scott, Mike, Irina, Jeff.
Yeah, I mean, I can take a first stab at that. The it's interesting because if you go out to the National Association of Corporate Directors and you look at what that organization does to train board members on how to ask management teams about the effectiveness of their security programs, they use the NIST CSF as a way to help educate board members around program effectiveness. And so when you have a security leader who's matching up their approach with the way the boards are generally being taught how to question or to interrogate management teams, it's a great, I mean, this industry is built on trust, right? And as leaders, we all want to establish that trust quickly. So aligning with that target state that we've established for the business, and measurements of our progress through time from our current state in each of the different areas of the CSF framework is a great way to show the board that you're driving it on improvements in KPIs, moving the business towards this target state, and establishing measurable benefits for the business long-term that the board can relate to.
Look, the board meeting is a spark. It's supposed to energize the whole organization to get aligned before that moment of truth when time is so precious and you have to tap dance very eloquently. And it's not about using the board meeting to pressure different executives across the organization in front of a higher authority. It's supposed to be something that coalesces the organization before they get to that point. So use the board meeting as a catalyst to prepare and to foster conversations across the organization with your peers, with, you know, Mike leading security products, for example, and Scott leading innovation program and R&D investment. Now, how would those two folks who seemingly have competing objectives come back to the board and say, you know, we agree this is the right way to create an investment plan? And if you look to the board to answer the question, you haven't done your job. So it starts by looking to your left and right. I guess we're looking at screens now, but it's still your peers that you're talking to. And if you're not managing those relationships and you're focusing only on managing upwards, the board's going to understand that, and then there's going to be a big problem. A bigger problem.
Yeah, then it's more than a spark, right?
Yeah, exactly. But the bigger problem is when you're not managing those conversations and, you know, there's not the courage to describe the problems. And the CISO, the CTO, whoever that steps in front of the board, the executive team, and says, everything is fine, right? Everything's normal. We're back to normal, by gosh. I think there's a huge challenge there. There's a huge ethical issue there. Mike and I were talking about this. So if you've set that expectation that everything's fine, you know, knowing what most folks now know about the world and the level of nation-sponsored cyber attack, I think you've painted yourself into a corner. Mike, are we on the same page with that?
Yeah, I think the security leader's job is to constantly make sure that expectations around the business approach to managing risk inside the company, the allocation of those resources into a cybersecurity or a privacy program, the leader's job is to make sure that those expectations always line up. And when there isn't a systemic view of that or there's not a systematic way to approach that, what often happens is, you know, it becomes a personal credibility issue on the line, meaning, you know, this person's been doing this for 20 years. He's been with our company a long time. He's always kept stuff going just fine. And really what happens then is the executives are looking at the tops of the surface of the water. They don't see any problem. And the CISO may or may not, the security leader may or may not have a really good view of what's going on deep inside of the organization. And I think that's the source of some of the angst that you see in the leadership ranks within the field that make it hard to match up what the executives believe is happening, what's actually happening, and then the allocation of investments towards closing that gap.
Kacy, who was that question from?
That's a good question.
Well, in any case, I don't want to be personal about it, but
I believe it was Caleb.
Caleb, yes, thank you. So my advice for Caleb, here's your homework assignment, is, you know, go back to, you know, these leaders in your organization that are, you know, especially the ones that have some revenue generating scope of responsibility, and understand what their intentions and motivations and plans are, and see if you can distill that into a short two-sentence description of what they're trying to do and how you're partnered with them to help achieve that. That's what the board and the executive team want to see. The other side of it, when folks settle for less than that or accept this position that everything's copacetic, that and that, that ethical challenge, I think maybe that's something Irina can talk about. I mean, Irina, are you hearing folks struggle with these types of issues? Like, how do we resolve this leadership question of when a CISO, for example, is allowed to paint themselves into a corner? Is that the board or the executive team hanging them out to dry?
So I'm going to try to kick this elsewhere. At the center where I work, we have a number of different programs. I'm the director of the Internet Ethics Program. We have a whole separate program on business ethics and leadership ethics. And I suspect that they have a lot of material and insights into those questions, but I don't want to claim that I do. So I would say that's sort of outside my scope. Sorry.
I know that that's okay. I know that we're approaching the top of the hour, and I do have one more question from the audience that I'd like to throw out there for each of you to take a stab at answering. What are the biggest gaps the panel has seen between cybersecurity's perspective of risk and business view of risk, and what behaviors are critical for both parties to exhibit in order to be properly aligned? Mike, why don't we start with you?
Sure, I could take the first step. I think the biggest gaps, again, come, you know, from the bias that we start with, right? Because in general, the business is worried about cybersecurity, but they also take the approach that the allocation of resources is challenging, especially during a pandemic. The allocation of resources is challenging, and we want to allocate resources to things that go towards creating the most value, not things that try to prevent the most damage. And if we're a CISO or a security leader who's working with kind of that optimistic view, then we're challenged to kind of talk about things as risk avoidance, right? Because if we're taking the view that the pessimistic view that maximum damage is what our risk models should plan for, then if we're doing internal software development, we really ought to think carefully about letting anyone stray off of the golden path and create something that we can't control, because the assumption is that in a maximum damage model, that's going to spin out and create huge problems for us. So I think the biggest gaps are really aligning those, to get back to the question, the biggest gaps are aligning those questions around the expectations that we've set and the objectives that we're trying to achieve, and making sure we understand our biases and how we communicate that. Using a systematic tool like the NIST CSF makes it easier to surface those biases, to set that target state with the business, and then work collectively to that. From that standpoint, it gets more kind of the personality and the individual out of the discussion and really helps them manage the program instead of just manage fires or manage individual events.
I think it's really interesting that preventing damage is presented as kind of a dichotomy, the other side of creating value. And it does seem to me like sometimes the cybersecurity folks or the privacy folks or the ethicists in general are sort of seen as the naysayer who are roadblocks to innovation. But if together they help prevent damage, that means that the innovation that comes out will add value to our lives and will be robust products that people will be happy to use, that technologists will be happy to develop and proud to develop. And we can no longer pretend that those are two distinct separate things, the prevention of harm and the creation of value.
Yeah, that's a good point, Irina. That those two things have to be joined together. Right.
Absolutely. Well, we are just about at the top of the hour here. So thank you all much, Jeff.
Can I give you one more quick thought there?
Sure.
Sorry, Kacy. I think the thing that's missing and what inspired and kind of bring this full circle, I think the thing that's missing is an appetite for bad news, valuing bad news, and an appetite for anticipation. And so, you know, thinking back on conversations where I might pose some off-the-wall scenario and folks come back years later and say, wow, like that seemed far-fetched and now it seems relevant. I think that's why these conversations become so important and why I'd like to continue them.
Excellent. Thank
you. Yeah, I think you're spot on, Jeff.
Jeff, Irina, Mike, and Scott, thank you so much for joining us today. Listeners, thanks for joining in. And don't forget that this webcast was recorded and you will be receiving an email to listen again and again. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Kacy.
Thank you, everybody. Take care.